Thank you. Thank you, Chief Parker, for inviting me. I'm glad I'm here. I want half the room full. But you know what? I'm glad you guys are here. So first, she already introduced me. I've been a detective. I've actually been in the department for 23 years. I'm actually retiring in June. I had enough. But of course, it's not gonna stop me pull this down. I always think I sound like Mickey Mouse on the film here. But I love my job. And when I took this job, the one thing I said, if I don't make an impact, I'm wasting time. If I'm not gonna be, you know, effective in the community, I'm wasting my time. And that's one thing I don't like to do. And it's funny, because I just started as a meter maid. I'm from New York, from the Bronx. I grew up in the projects. I had no idea I was gonna be the popo. That was not in my job, you know, my job. I didn't wanna be the greatest cop, no, that was not in my thing. I used to be a social worker. So, and it's so funny, because now 20 years later, I'm a social worker with a gun. That's all the thing has changed, right? So, but I enjoy what I do, it's a very good career, and I've had the opportunity, I'm gonna show you guys this video. I don't know if some of you guys have seen it, they played it on ESPN commercials, I've seen it in a movie, I saw it in a movie theater, and I was just telling someone, I said, I was in a movie theater, and I went early during the day, so it was me and three of my girlfriends, and there was four other people in the theater, and a commercial came, I stood up, I was like, that's me. My friend's like, sit down. And then the other four people was like, oh, yeah, that's you, oh, good job, you know, but it's so funny to see yourself. But I thought this was, I had the pleasure of working with the past attorney general, and I'll be going forward with the new attorney general, because he's very appreciative of this campaign. And it all came about because, again, as Chief Parker mentioned, that I work with Noble, and I'm here on behalf of Noble, which is the National Organization of Black Law Enforcement Executives. So what we do this presentation, a national initiative about police interaction, because we see what's going on out here. We understand what's happening. And as officers, it's like, hold up, that's not the norm, and it shouldn't be the norm. And we try to educate the youth, because if you know better, you do better. Same thing with us. And that's why our attorney general educates all the officers in the state of New Jersey, because he is the top cop. So we've gotten all this training, and one thing that he saw and was the missing point was we're not educating the public, because they don't know. And you don't know the laws, and you won't know the laws unless you're in law enforcement, or unless you're trying to get a law degree. You just won't know. So he took it upon himself, you know, once he saw me do a presentation, and he was like, you're it. And Shaquille O'Neal tried to steal my thunder, but I got him, right? So we're just gonna play this real quick. Tell you a little bit what this is about. Talks about safe stops, because that seems to be the hot button nowadays, what's going on with law enforcement.
Hi, I'm Kim Nelson Edwards. I'm a mother, a grandmother, and I also happen to be a detective in Montclair, New Jersey. I want to talk about traffic stops. I've made plenty over the years, and I've been stopped myself. I understand how stressful they can be. The best things you can do in a traffic stop is to stay calm, know your rights, and know the law. Here's some other tips. Stay in your car. If it's dark, turn on the dome light. Make sure that your window is rolled down. Have your hands on the steering wheel. When the officer asks for your license, registration, and insurance card, please provide them. That's the law. If the officer asks you to exit the vehicle, please do it. Again, that's the law. If you feel that you didn't deserve to be pulled over or were treated unfairly, file a complaint. That's your right. Remember, my job is to keep everyone safe. To learn more, go to safestopnj.com.
So this web, this is on the Attorney General's website. And one of the things that I would say, if you can go into the Safe Stop Tips, I would definitely take this down, because if you go on the Safe Stop Tips, you'll see we kind of break it down. And then there's other videos. Shaquille O'Neal has one. One of the guys from the Giants has one. So there's a lot of, and there's a lot of information that you just have to know. The street is not the place for a dispute. You can file a complaint. Like all these things, and I just thought it was just a good idea. And one of the things you can go on there, can you get the other video? When you go on there, you can take a pledge. And it's a safe stop pledge. So they can get a magnet. It's a big magnet. When they sent me this, I was like, wow, that's kind of big. I don't know if I want that on my car. Or you can get a sticker. And what this does, it shows the officer that may pull you over that you've taken this pledge and you understand your rights and you know the law pretty much, you know, within your parameters. And that this way now he understands, oh, wait a minute, I've got the training too. So now I know. It's kind of like, okay, we're both on the same page. So this stop should go very smooth, you know, and that's the thing. So I'm doing trainings around the state of New Jersey, again, about this, because they'll see them on the car. So all the new recruits will be able to know what that is on their car. But besides that, one of the things that he promised was that people file complaints. But now he wants to make sure that within 30 days that your complaint is heard and something is done. He vowed that that was going to happen. So the Attorney General's office now, within 30 days, they are to get a complaint here down in this town or whatever town you live in, if, as long as it's in New Jersey, that their office will look into it if you don't get a response within 30 days. Because now we have to send to him what our departments are doing as far as your complaint. And that was his whole idea. So he thought about everything. So I'm kind of proud to be a part of that whole process. Now that was just a little bonus. This is the Lawnya community. Like I said, we do this on a national level. I am the regional trainer here and a presenter here in this state along with some others, but we pretty much just want to kind of educate you guys, let you know what we're doing, how we're doing it, why we're doing it, and your rights. Because you need to know you do have rights. We do this for a lot of young folks, and I say juveniles. This is a project. This is just, I have to do a disclaimer. Department of Justice, they gave us money for this, but it's not their words. These are our words. So if I say something, it's a Kimism. Another disclaimer is, if anything like this, we're giving you just worst case scenarios. This is not precise recitations of the law unless I know for sure. And I, like I said, I've been in law enforcement for 20 plus years. I know the law. I'm not going to give you the wrong law. No, we're not giving you legal counsel. We advise you to contact a personal criminal attorney in respect to any and all subject matter if you find yourself in legal trouble. Don't say, oh, well, Detective Nelson said, no. Again, we're going to talk about law enforcement and community policing, the rules of engagement, action decision that makes a person a criminal, and democracy and laws. And it's funny because they added those last two pieces on because a lot of people forget how laws are made. And it's funny because a lot of adults forget how laws are made. We grew up with Conjunction Junction. Everybody know that Schoolhouse Rock? That's what we grew up with. So we knew, you know, a bill is a bill. You know, we knew that. So unfortunately, unless you're in these classes, a lot of times you won't get that education. You just, and especially now what's going on in politics, you probably like, what the heck is happening? So they added that part. So this is my Kimisms. You're going to hear a lot of funny little things that I made up. But we want to obtain a better understanding of certain job functions of law enforcement that will help you bridge the gap between law enforcement and the community. That is our goal. We want to clarify myths about the actual law and educate you about your rights and have open dialogue about your concerns. So I'm going to be up here, but you will not be able just to sit there. You can stop me at any time by raising your hand and asking me a question or say, what about this, you know. Please, I want this to be interactive. This is not just me preaching. So if you have any questions, and we're going to do some scenarios as well, because it's important that you see it and you know it firsthand so that you'll understand it clearly. Got it? So here's some statistics that we've garnered, and they're actually very accurate. Black male born in 91 is 29% chance of spending time in prison at some point in his life. Nearly one in three African-American males, 2029, are under some form of criminal justice supervision, jail, parole, probation. Like, these stats are not made up. One out of nine African-American men will be incarcerated. So all these things, we know that. And as law enforcement officers, we know that we're responsible for a lot of it. We have to look at the both sides. So we talk about perception versus reality. Our job is hard. Everybody knows it's difficult and dangerous. When we do motor vehicle stops, I don't know who I'm pulling over. I just don't. You know, so, you know, a lot of times you may see some, you know, we talk about that. You may say, oh, wow, that's a bit excessive. It's five cars and only one car. But you have to look at, that's again, it's your perception, but our reality that I needed backup. So we'll talk about that a little bit too. So our job is, so we have to maintain a defensive posture until we believe the risk of confrontation or injury is diminished. Case in point. I told you I'm gonna be using you, right? So, if I'm, and this is what I like to say, so I'm a righty, so my gun is here. So if I'm approach him, you're gonna see me stand like this. I'm gonna have a bladed stance, and I'm gonna, you know, because what am I doing? I'm just in case I have to get to my gun. So I may look like we get ready to shoot blows, right? But I'm not gonna fight him. I just have to kind of blade myself so this way I can, I'll keep myself at a distance. I'm keeping my gun away from him. So I'm taking this stance because if I have to move back and retreat, or if I have to go forward and, you know, so whatever I need to do, and that's why it looks like we're getting ready to shoot the ones. No, we're not. So it may look like this. So people are looking at them, they're like, oh my God, I look like you're getting ready to fight. No, this is the stance that we take. If you're a lefty, it's this way too. So, and I'm gonna give you respect, I'm gonna give you that eye contact, and we're gonna have a conversation, but this is why it looks like very defensive. So when you see this, like, why does it also look like he's getting ready to fight? No, this is what we're doing. And of course, if you've ever seen a gun belt, it's got everything on, it's like Batman. Everything you can think of is on that stupid belt. So we have to make sure that we're protecting ourselves and you as well, okay? Thank you. So sometimes, again, you see these things and there's a breakdown in communication between law enforcement and the community, especially young adults, because of what they're seeing. Constantly on Facebook and YouTube and everything, Snapchat and whatever else is out there. You see, they show the same videos over and over again about these police confrontations. They show you this snippet of just one piece over and over and over again. The same way that we see things happening, say, with African Americans in crime. They show this one, they just keep showing it over and over and over again. I'm like, whoa, wait. White people get arrested too. Spanish people get arrested too. Asian people get arrested too. Everybody, you know, it's not like it's just exclusive. So we have to be educated. We have to be smart about what we're seeing. So the public perception of law enforcement is so important. It's important that our reputations and that you have trust and that you can't, but right now we see what's going on, it's not happening. And this is why Noble is out here trying to change that so you can understand what's going on. And you can't paint everybody with that one paintbrush with the same thing. The same way you don't want to be judged the same way, we don't want everybody else to judge us. I gotta get closer to this. So community policing, it allows officers to demonstrate their support for the community. Residents and police are supposed to be allies. I'm a detective. There's no way I can do my job. No way, unless I had help from the community. Now, if you didn't like me and I said, hey, I need some help, and I come up to you and say, what's your name? Tommy. Tommy, did you see that shooting over there? Man, I'll mess with the police, get out of here. But Tommy and I know Tommy, I'm respectful of Tommy, I treat Tommy the same way that I treat everybody else. I say, hey, Tommy, you see anything? Oh, Nelson, man, he's willing to talk to me and we can solve the crime. Now I can get something done. If I don't have a relationship with you or with the community where they trust and believe in me, I'm not gonna get any of my crime solved. None. I have kids telling me and young adults, because I'm an SRO too, a school resource officer, but I have people, I haven't been on the street in years, like walking the beat. But I have people, if I go out on the street and I'm investigating something, they're like, hey, Nelson, what's up? And they'll come over and they'll tell me everything. And everybody's looking at me like, no, I'm not a unicorn. I said, but this is what I've earned respect over the years with people because I treat them fairly. So people are not afraid to talk to me. They don't feel like they're snitching. They don't feel, they feel like, no, you can't, gonna help you. And they be like, yo, tell Nelson. Nelson will get it done. So I'm kind of like, okay, good. Because that's what, I'm not supposed to be that unicorn. That's how it's supposed to work. And that's how we have to remember. So like I said, you know better, then expect better. Because I'm telling you, that's not a rarity, that's how it works. We're supposed to work together. So we talk about negative attention and positive attention, and that's just common sense. And sometimes we forget, and how many freshmen in here? None? Good. So sophomores. Oh, he's 14th grade. Okay, so, you know, it's funny. I look at it that way because, I mean, we can still make silly mistakes. We have adults that's doing the same thing. Like, come on, you didn't know you're supposed to walk on the sidewalk? What's wrong with the sidewalks? I don't know, sometimes it's this thing about sidewalks and young people. Nobody wants to walk on the sidewalk. Like you know, step on a crack, break your mother's back or something. Like, what's wrong with it? So if you're walking in the street, what do you think is gonna happen? Somebody's gonna walk up to the police, somebody's gonna call the police, these kids are walking in the street. You know, okay, you just brought attention to yourself that was unnecessary. So I'm gonna tell you, get off the sidewalk, and you're gonna say, you don't have to tell me where, you know, get off the street. Now you're gonna tell me where I gotta walk into. No, there is a rule and a law on the books that says you can't walk in the street. Only cars belong on the road. You have to walk on the sidewalk. So there are laws. So again, if you don't know, and you think you know, because of course, most of you guys are street lawyers and all your friends, they know all the laws. I'm like, ooh, I go to them all the time, not. So you have to think of those. You have to use common sense. You don't want to bring attention to yourself that can, you know, bring negative attention, bring us. We don't want to come unless we have to. A lot of times we don't come unless we're called. So let's do things if you're stopped. If you're stopped, questioned, or detained by law enforcement. Again, you got to approach him or her with respect. I'm sorry, if we're officers, we're in uniforms, this is our job, we're getting paid to do this. We're authority, whether you like it or not. Whether you like it or not, it is what it is. We're the law, okay? We have to have some law and order in this country. So just be respectful. Now, you may get the attitude, right? Well, no, I'm not gonna use you again. Thomas, come on. So you're just walking, you're coming from campus. You just walk this. If I see him walking like that, I'm like, oh, he's doing jazzercise. Right, so put your hands in your pockets, so walk, right? Excuse me, sir. So now, I'm gonna ask him, can you stop? Someone say, sir, where are you coming from? Can you take your hands out your pockets? I'm gonna always ask them to take their hands out their pockets. Do you know, God? You guys know why? Common sense, right? I need to see your hands at all times because the hands are quicker than the eye. I need to see your hands at all times because I'm looking at you. I need to see your hands. I need to make sure I'm like, you know, I may even do a pat down. Is it legal for me just to pat him down? Is it legal? You said no? You think is it legal? Y'all, see, you gotta know the law. I can pat him down for officer safety. I have probable cause. I have probable cause to stop him. Because I got a call. See, y'all didn't know that I got a bolo. A bolo is be on the lookout. So I got a bolo, a white male, about 5'10", 5'11", black shirt, black sneakers, gray jeans. He just robbed a convenience store. That's what came over the air for me. So I'm stopping him. I'm stopping for a reason. So now, officer safety got his hands in his pocket. Let me see your hands. Because now he just robbed a convenience store. Can I dig in his pockets? No. But we can do that. I can pass him, make sure, oh, what is that? Take that out your pocket. It's a cell phone. But what if I didn't know what that was, right? So at this point, I got backup, right? I know that, okay, it's a cell phone. I'm not gonna make him take it out. But I can definitely, where a gun would be or a knife, I can definitely pat him. Can I search him on the street like that? But as a pat, yes. Called a Terry frisk. So I can do that, it's legal. But I better have a reason. You understand? I have to be able to articulate that. So this is why you need to know these laws. See, people tell you, no, they can't touch it. That's not true. It's the same way in New Jersey, we don't have a stop and frisk, because no reason, just no apparent, lucky day. Thomas, you're lucky day. I'm just gonna stop you and frisk you. We don't have that in New Jersey. Like in some states, they have that. There's 24 states that have the stop and frisk. New Jersey's not one of them. I patted him down for officer safety to make sure there was no weapons because I got a bolo, so I have probable cause. Now, some states, you can stop and frisk. I don't know how that works because we can't do that just because I felt like it. So, need to know that. The 24 states, you need to see. You guys from Jersey? Okay, so in this state we don't have, but we do have a halt law. And I meant to bring that article because I saved it from the Star Ledger. So from ages 8 on up, if we say stop, you don't have a right to be like, man, I don't have to stop. You don't have the right to not stop. And if you didn't do anything wrong, why wouldn't you stop? You don't have the right. You don't have to incriminate yourself. And I'll talk about that. Retain your composure, right? You want to conduct yourself in a mature manner. And you want to, again, avoid any action or language that might trigger a more volatile situation. So again, if I said take your hands out your pockets and you didn't, what do you think is going to happen? No, I already told you I was in control, that I'm the authority. So you don't do what I say, there's gonna be a problem because I need to be in control of this scene. You have to know what our job is. Our job is to bring the peace and to enforce the law. So if you're not cooperating, you're taking it to another level that it doesn't have to be. But now you do have rights. And you can ask me, why did you stop me? Don't be afraid to ask, why did you stop me? Well, Thomas, the reason why I stopped you because we got to look at what I see, it's not you. Well, Thomas, I have to give you a reason why I stopped you. Look at my badge. Okay, I don't have my uniform on, but everybody has their badge and they have their number. You can look at my car number. Look at your clock. You see it's 10, whatever. There's a clock. Look at the car number. And you're going to report that. This cop just stopped me for no reason or wouldn't tell me why. And you need to complain. What happens is, and I'm going to tell you, a lot of things will happen in the street and nobody complains about it. Oh, no, you're going to tell your homies. You go in the barbershop and the beauty parlor and the nail, man, I got, and you tell all the wrong people, who cares? They don't care. You got to go to the police department. You can do it anonymously. You can have somebody do it for you. But you got to complain about this officer that's stopping people and don't have the right. Because guess what? If you don't make the complaint, it didn't happen. So your priority when you get a stop is, again, you want to alleviate or minimize the potential charges of force against you. So if I ask you, Thomas, take your hands out your pockets. Take hands out your pockets. That's a simple request. You know, now if you don't, I can go the next step, and the law says that. Okay? Thank you. If you're stopped in the street, remember, you're not required to give testimony against yourself. You have Fifth Amendment rights. If I say, where, ask you where you're going, you can say, I'm coming from, or where you coming from? I'm coming from the grocery store. If you know of a crime, you don't have to say, yeah, I did it, I robbed. You don't have to say any of that. You don't have to incriminate yourself. You don't have to give testimony against yourself if you know you did commit a crime. You don't have to. Just say, I don't know what you're talking about. I'm just coming from the grocery store and leave it like that. It's up to me to do my job. You don't have to incriminate yourself. Do not badmouth or walk away, even if you feel I'm 100% wrong. You don't have no right to stop me. Oh, you sucker, blah, 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 blah. Don't do that. Just, okay. Look at that card number. Look at the time. Remember my badge. Remember what I look like. He was the cute officer with the... But you want to remember these things because it's going to be important to you later on. But, you know, a lot of us, we get afraid. And it's okay to be fearful because most officers, when they step out of the car, they never know what they're going to get. They don't know who they're going to deal, who they're dealing with. So we're afraid as well. You know, we're ready. We're on the ready. Because we don't know what type of confrontation we may have. We may have mental illness. Now I have to deal with you a different way. You may have just committed a crime. So you're going to do what you got to do. So we don't know, just like you don't know. But the easiest way is just to be calm, just follow the instructions. And I'm telling you, it goes quickly. And if there's a problem, you have to report it. And you have to obey all requests made, and you also pose a risk to your safety. Now, if I stop you in the middle of the street, officer, can we get out the street? I don't want to get hit by a car. If I say lay down on the ground, well there's glass on the ground, you know? So you want to have, it has to be a reason why you're not. What I always say, comply first, complain later. That's my little kidism. Comply first, complain later. Because you know what? You're going to have a word. You're going to have the opportunity to say something about what happened. If you don't, and if we look at a lot of the things that happen, if you look at compliance, we talk about compliance, and I don't understand, just coming a little old school, when it was okay to just disrespect authority. Like, no, that's normal. It's what you're supposed to do. Like, okay, well, I don't know. Last time I heard, you guys don't have that right to, and you need to know that. And so if you're doing that, now we shouldn't be disrespectful either. And I know it's out there because I got stopped, and this guy was so disrespectful to me. And I was like, well, wait a second. Like, what did I do? Was I speeding? He didn't even give me an opportunity to say anything. So I knew in my brain what I had to do. I was real calm about it. I was calm and cool. I just pulled out my license, my registration, insurance, and my police ID, and then his story. Oh, you know, but you yelled at me. You did this. You did all of this for no reason. And then we had a conversation. And then he was telling me about some things that happened. I was like, okay, but you can't take your personal, you know, we are humans. So because my wife yelled at me this morning, I'm not going to get up in the morning and say, everybody I meet today, you know, my husband yelled at me, I'm going to curse him out. No, that's not how it works. You know, so, but that was that situation. He really told me that. I was like, yo, bro, what's up? Like, you just came at me. He said, man, I had a rough morning. Oh, you know how it is. No, I don't treat people like that. I never do, and I haven't in the 20 years, 20 plus years I've been, I just don't, because I have to understand we're human. So we're going to have those days. I have to leave that at home. When I come and put that uniform on, I have my gun and my badge on, I have to become different. I have to forget about that the rent's due and I had to pay my mortgage and my daughter didn't do what she was supposed to do. I have to take that out of there. Sometimes it doesn't happen, and we have to remember we're humans too. If you stopped in the car, all right, set my car up. So we're gonna set up an SUV. Nah, we only got four cars, four seats. We'll set up a regular Toyota Corolla. Or Lexus, how about that? Nobody wants to ride in a Corolla. Give me some passengers. Come on, I need four passengers. Okay, he's driving. You get to have a gun. You get to bottle of vodka. You get to bottle of Henny. And let's see, we're gonna put the cocaine. Matter of fact, you get the cocaine and we'll put the gun right here. How about that? So, let's talk about a motor vehicle stop. How many of you guys drive, right? Everybody drives? How scary it is to get pulled over? You never got pulled over? Good for you. And you, how was you? Were you? You were terrified. Like, oh my God! Okay, right, driver, you've been pulled over before. How did it feel? Was your hands sweating and your heart was pounding? Like, oh shoot, right? So yes. So now I see four people in the car. I'm pulling you over. It's 12:30 at night. How do you think I feel? Oh shoot, there's four people in the car, it's midnight, I don't know what I got here, right? So now you guys are in the car. Let me tell you how, I'm gonna stand in front of you so you can see. So let me tell you how this works. So I pull you over. You know why it takes me so long to get out the car? Because number one, we ride single man cars. So if I had a two man car, then we'll get out the car. But I'm waiting for backup. I am not getting out my car until I have a backup. So that's why in my town, you may see two cars and I'm pulling over one car. And people drive by, wow, they gotta have two cars? Yeah, because I'm riding by myself. So I wait for backup. Not only that, I'm running your plate. So it takes time. These are computers, we have MDTs in our cars. It takes time for the information to pop up. So your driver's license actually pops up on my screen if the car is registered to you. If it's your mom's car, it will come up with your mom's name. So, and I'm like, oh, okay, that's not the mother, you know. But if your mom's license is suspended, if the car's unregistered, things like that, that will pop up. Like everything will go off on the MDT, beep, 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 beep. And they tell me her car, her registration is suspended, or, you know, no insurance or whatever. All that information comes up and your mom's driver's license comes up. So that's why it takes time for us, because I'm waiting for that to come back from the DMV. So one of the other things that we'll do is, just so you guys can see. So behind, if you see our cars, we kind of pivot them. And that's for a reason. That's so I can get out the way if I have to, or if you take off, then I have a way. And then also I'm blading the car so that this way is protection for me. If I have to go, so if I get out the car in this way, I can get back in the car, I can use it as cover. So you may see it's parked against the curb, it's facing outwards, it's not kind of directly behind you. So now I'll pull you up. I'm coming up, say, I need a partner. Not, come on, Thomas, you already worked. You wanna do some more work? Come on, you're my partner. Thomas is my partner. Come up on the stage, you're the partner. So, partner, you gotta follow my lead, right? So, when we're pulling up to a car, we're looking. As we're pulling, come on, partner, we're looking. Yep, you gotta be on that side. You're my partner. Get yourself ready, right? We're looking in the car because I want to look and see the car. Now, pretend you don't see the gun. Y'all can at least hide the vodka in the Henny. Just hide it, right? But say you just throw the bottle. Put the bottle right there. Like, oh, shoot, God, I don't want to get caught with that, right? We don't see this yet. But, so we're doing a regular motor vehicle stop. So, how would you stop him? Now you got, what's your name?
John.
You got John over there now. So, talk to John. Yeah, get in character. Let's go. Okay. So what you want to do is always what the officer should do, if he's doing it right, say, good evening, my name is Detective Nelson Edwards. Can I have your license, registration, and insurance? Now, this is what kills me. My car, I drive a Yukon Denali XL. And it's junky, because I'm an event planner on the side. So I always have kind of junk in the car. I could never find anything. And if any, like any of us, we got our glove compartments are filled with stuff. Everything is everywhere. So I went and bought this car wallet. This car wallet costs $1. I can put everything in here. My license, no, not my license, but my registration, my insurance card. So I keep it in here. It costs $1. Invest in one if you're a driver. So this way you can always put your hand on it. Second thing, like you guys gotta stop digging. Why, this is 2018. Why are you digging still in your glove box and in your center console? You can actually put this above your visor. You see this little clip? Anybody seeing these clips? They cost $1. You can put your sunglasses in them. So I put my sunglasses in them, but I keep this above there, and then my wallet goes in here. So now I pull, your hands are always visible to the officer. So I pull the visor down, and everything's right there. I give him the, here you go. Take it out, because I don't want that. I won't take this. You have to take it out. Here's my license, my registration. Get your license, sir. If, where's your wallet? So it's using your back pocket. So then you say, I'm going to get my wallet. I'm going to get my wallet. Okay. You get your wallet. You get your stuff out. You have to hand in your information within a certain amount in a reasonable amount of time. If you're still digging and you're looking for your new registration, you probably got 100 new insurance cards in here because people don't throw them away. They act like they're gold. Like, you don't get points if you hold on to them. Shred them when the old one, when you get the old one, shred it. If you're in mom's car, you need to know where that stuff is before you take off. You guys are responsible. As a driver, you need to know where this information is. So you have to know where it is. Get it out, put it over this, wherever you have to put it, so you know, if you, just in case you get pulled over, I know where it is. Well, this is my mom's car. This is my uncle's car. I don't know where it is. It doesn't work. So you're going to get a summons. You're going to get a summons for not producing it. Even with the insurance, you have to produce it within a certain amount of time. I don't have to wait all day for you to say, I found it. No. I have to go. I have to move on. So you can bring it to court and you can say, I found it. You're still going to get a $129 ticket. Yes. It's not good. But see, and this is what happens. Now, he said, can I see it on my screen? Yes. So if I see his registration and it's good and insurance is good, guess what? I'm not going to give him a ticket for not having it. Because he's got insurance. I believe him. I'm not going to give him not having the car registered because the registration is good. I know it. You don't have it, though. You have to produce it when I ask for it. So I won't give you a ticket for not having it, which is very expensive, and then I can tow your car. I'm going to give you a ticket for not producing it, and that's about $130 a ticket for each one, for the registration, for the insurance, for the license. And even, you know, you may not have your license, but I can pull it up. Right. So if this is your mom's car, and then I say, well, your license, and I can look, you say, oh, I don't have my license. I take your name, and I go in the back, and I look it up. And then I can find. So I won't give you the ticket for not having it. I'm going to give you for not producing, for not having a license. It's for not producing it. So you can get those, you know, if you get off and don't want to have time, you may just say, oh, no, as far as I'm concerned, you don't have a license. But they'll take a few minutes out to see if you have a valid license. But you should have it. Clip thing. Just go to the dollar store. They have all this stuff in there. So now, that's a regular stop. Here we go. Come on back, Thomas. Here we go. We coming back. So I'm looking. So I'm giving you the eye. I'm looking like this. Like, I see something. There's the bottle. That's why you need to know who's in your car, too. Then I look. You see that? What you say? Gun! That's what you say, gun. Because guess what? Now it changes this whole scope, right? Now we find a gun. Everybody's getting pulled. I'm pulling you through the window. And now everybody's coming out the car. No, seriously. It doesn't matter. I see a gun in the middle of the floor, because if it's registered, you're going to have a gun in the middle of the floor. You're going to have it where? In a case, because unless you have a carry license, which I'm quite sure none of you will probably get, but if that gun is there, it changes the whole shoot. It's a gun. Now our lives are in danger. So our guns come out. So you probably have a gun to your head, a gun to your head, and you, yeah. That's the reality. We may not shoot you, but you're going to have that gun to your head. And I've had that happen several times. I've pulled my gun out several times because I've seen a gun. So now, you get out the car. You're out the car. We're going to take, sit on the curb. We're going to cuff you, whatever. We're going to get the gun, blah, blah, blah. Is that your gun?
No.
Is that your gun? Is that your gun? Is that your gun? Guess whose gun it is? Say, who said that? Say it. It's everybody's gun. That gun belongs to everybody, not him. That gun belongs to everyone. You took it out your purse, you threw it on the floor. You're not gonna claim it, but it belongs to everyone. So now we get out the car, right? Everybody's out the car. So I see the bottle of vodka, just the vodka. So I'm like, well, that's near her, but it is an open container, and these guys are all under 21. I'll charge them. Then you get out the car, and I look, and she's got the Hennessy. Like, oh boy, now we got open containers. Here we go, more tickets. She gets out the car after we do a search of her, because now I have probable cause to do a search because of what? The gun. So you're gonna get searched. Not just a pat down, you're gonna get searched. So I find the cocaine. This came out of her pocket, so everybody, she's gonna get charged with the cocaine. She's gonna get charged with cocaine, but guess what he's gonna get? He's gonna get a ticket for having drugs in the car. So you can lose your license up to 2 years. That's why you need to know who's in your car, whose car you're getting into, because you don't know. You need to know when you're driving who's in your car, make sure they don't have no foolishness on them, and make sure they don't get you in trouble and make you lose your license. Now, okay, so now, here we go, another scenario. Okay, Thomas, you ready? Pull up. So you ask John for his license, registration, insurance, start being the agency. You don't have to get him that. Come on. Here we go. We got the loudmouth in the seat, right? We got a couple, y'all got a bunch of friends like that, right? You don't have to get him nothing. He on it. Guess what she just did? Man, we writing that ticket whether you was gonna get it or not. Your friends just talked you, just got you those tickets. So you have to be in control of your friends at all times, your passengers. You're responsible. You're responsible for your passengers. If they start acting crazy and have a bunch of foolishness and mayhem, guess what? Well, that one ticket that she was gonna get made turned into three. Oh, no seat belts, little tail lighter, And let me tell you, Title 39 is a very big book. It's stuff on the books that they haven't taken off. Like, you know, you're really not supposed to get out on this side, like say driver's side, we park this way, you're really not supposed to get out into the street. Crazy, they take that off the books. Yeah, like I'm supposed to go crawl on the other side. But if I want to get technical, we can give that. There's a lot of laws that are on this book, because Title 39 is very big, and that's the motor vehicle. So it's not criminal, it doesn't become criminal until you're juvenile. And I can charge you with the alcohol, underage drinking, so now you have criminal and you have Title 39. But most part, Title 39, it's just a ticket. It's just a ticket. It's a ticket, you drive without a license, okay, so what? You get a ticket. You drive without a license, you take off. So you were good, you stopped. I had the kids, when I do the Juvenile Justice Commission, I have kids, they said, we're not stopping, we're still going. I said, that's why you're still here. You didn't learn and it didn't work for you. You can't take off. I had a kid that actually, he was in jail. He got stopped 3 times for driving, but he didn't stop, he refused to stop. So when and it just so happens, he happened to be my driver. He said, I'm not stopping. Bruh, you locked up because of that, so it didn't work. It doesn't work that way. You can't outrun a radio. Can't outrun a radio, right? Then if we get the helicopter, can't outrun a helicopter. So you can't outrun community. So pullover is a ticket. You can fight it in court and you're not going to jail unless you have warrants. You have warrants, okay? Thank you guys. Oh wait, any questions about this? Any questions about motor vehicles? Yes, ma'am. Yes, we do accept that. Geico and somebody else has it, where it's electronic. We do take that, yes. If you can pull that up for me, that's good. That saves me trouble too. Any other questions about this motor vehicle stop? About motor vehicle stops? We don't want you to get out your car. Some people want to get out their car. Don't exit the vehicle unless you're asked to do so. But if I ask you to get out the car, you don't have a choice in the state of New Jersey. You have to get out the car. If I say get out the car, you have to exit the vehicle. And I'm gonna tell you, so when we turn on our lights in most states, most cars, most towns have it now. As soon as I turn my lights on, my camera comes on. And if you have body cams, those come on as well. We don't have body cameras in my town, but they do have them here. So we have body cams, our cameras on the cars, you know, so everything that you do is being recorded. The same way you can record. So let's talk about phones. Where's your cell phone, John? Right? So now you got your phone out and you're recording me. I'm good. Just always like, just get the good side. I don't care. This is 2018. I know you're going to have phones. This is what I don't want you to do. Like, you're interfering with my investigation. Put the phone down. You can record me, but don't be rude about it. That means you're not going to follow my instructions. So we don't want you to be disruptive. And if the officer says, I'm going to take your phone, it's illegal to record me, that's not true. In the state of New Jersey, it's not illegal to record an officer. You record us, it's not illegal. My suggestion is that you don't be disrespectful and don't hinder or obstruct my investigation while you're doing it. You can put it on the dashboard. You can do whatever you want. But if you have it up here, I'm going to tell you, get that thing, put it down. I need to talk. I'm trying to conduct business here, okay? So that's another thing, the phones. And people need, and this is why we have to police differently, because everybody's recording everybody. Yes, ma'am. Besides, well, again, for officer safety, say if I'm on a highway, like, I don't, these troopers, I don't know how they do it. I could never be a state trooper. So if he's on it and the cars are coming, he's gonna be like, I need you to get out the car so you can come around on this side. So now he's gonna conduct business. And I'm gonna tell you, that car is recorded. That, remember, I told you, it's recording. So come around if you want to stand in front of the car. The cameras are on, if you wanna have a conversation there. You know, if you're comfortable there. I know it's a very uncomfortable feeling getting out the car because you don't know, why am I getting out the car? You know, but he would say, look, I need you to get out the car because I don't want to get hit. And I don't want you to get, you know, so if a car just happens to come and slams into you, guess what? You'll back away and the car can get hit and you guys won't. So that would be a reason. It could be several reasons. He may have probable cause. He may smell something because it's about what we can articulate. What did you see? What did you smell? What did you hear? What, you know, those things, those facts, I have to be able to articulate why I had you at the car, why I searched you. I have to be able to do that. Let's talk about searches real quick in the car. So now, anything that your hands, put your hands out, it's free. Anything that you could touch, I can search all of this. Glove box, center console. But I have to have a reason. If I had no reason, I asked you. John, can I search your car? Game's over. That's how it's supposed to be. Game's over. He told me no. I don't really have a reason. I might have like a little hunch, but that doesn't fly. But I know I smell marijuana. I'm not going to ask you. I'm searching your car. I know I smell it. I can ask you, John, can I search your car? You can tell me no, and I'm going to say, you know what? Let's make a phone call. And I can get a warrant. Search warrant. This may take a minute. It has to be a reasonable amount of time. I can't keep you out here for an hour waiting for you to just wake up and all of that. Like, I have to have a, I better have a good reason. Probable cause. The trunk is very tricky. It's like almost impossible to legally get into a trunk. I can tell you we can get into your trunk. So now I see that gun, or I see I have paraphernalia, I have the alcohol, I have all of that. I'm impounding your car because you're getting arrested, right? Say I'm arresting you because I found a gun. Well, you get arrested. I'm impounding your car. What do I have to do to your car? Inventory. Because you'll be saying, she stole my $600 stereo system. It wasn't in there. You know, so I'm going to inventory your car, so I'm going to go in there. But on a good day, and say I didn't have all that to get into your trunk, unless you give me permission, I have to have a search warrant. And it's fruits of the poisonous tree. When you do go in there and you do find something, the judge will kick that out, be like, no good, the search was garbage, so guess what, you lose that. I'm gonna tell you, if I see a gun or anything like that, I don't care if it's a man and you're a woman and you're if I'm a female and you want a man to search, no. We don't, and a man can't search you up to a, so he ain't gonna go stand up. So he's gonna do the outside. He's gonna do this. He's gonna do what I did there with the back of his hand. Because we may not have females. There's only 11 officers on my job. So we may not have a female available, but you think I'm gonna wait to see if you have another gun on you to a female? No, we can do it with the back of our, with the man's, can, men can do it with the back of their hands. You know, we know where to search. We know where you might hide stuff, you know. We ain't gonna make you take your bra out and do all of that. No, we're not gonna do all that. But a man, a male officer can search a female officer, female. You can request a female, good luck with that, because if it's only 10 of us, and I don't work nights. So, you know, and the same thing with language barriers. We have to make sure we can get some officers that can speak different languages, you know, to do that. How many, anybody in here has an interest in law enforcement? Let me tell you something. It's a very good career. The average officer in the state of New Jersey makes $94,000 a year. So if you don't want that money, somebody else is coming to get that dough. That's all I gotta say. Somebody else coming to get that dough, Ray, me. And then you have a good pension system. But where's my retired sister? She's out there. You know, you get a good pension. So I get to work hard, but I play even harder. And it's a very good career. And you get to be impactful. This is your community. And if you're not policing your community, you don't like the way the police in your community, then you have a responsibility to your community to police your own community. You're giving the job to somebody else. And then you get mad when they're not policing the way you want it to be done. You can't have it both ways. You're either part of the solution or you're part of the problem. Or you're gonna be that complainer when you could have that job and making a difference. So it's something to think about. Like, don't just discount it. It's a very good career. Because you get to do stuff like I'm doing. You know, you chart your own way. So it's just something to think about. So about the females and the big deal, so we can, you can request, but like I said, good luck. You know, but if it's emergent, I'm not gonna wait for a female officer because you could shoot me within that time. I found one gun, more than likely if it's one gun, it's two guns. If it's one knife, it's two knives. And that's how we have to think. You good? Okay. Thank you guys. Did I do my clicker? Put it somewhere. Where's the clicker? Aha! I found it. So everybody got that, right? Everybody know about the motor vehicle stops pretty much? Again, we're gonna talk about getting out the car, right? Get out the automobile if you have to do so. If you believe you've been treated unfairly, this is not the time to have court. You can't have court on the street, because guess who's gonna win? Me. I already told you, we have the authority. So you're not going to win on the street. You're going to take something that was very simple as a motor vehicle stop and turn it into something that's out of control now. Right, so just comply. You can go to court. That's where you argue about your ticket. It's not illegal, like I said, to record the interaction with your cell phone, but it shouldn't interfere with us doing our job. Now, we're talking about search warrant. Oh, y'all left your Bach in your Henny? No. So we talk about coming to your door, we have search warrants. So I have a warrant that's already signed by the judge. So I know I'm coming to your house and I'm looking for you. So I'm coming to look for you. I'm looking for Thomas. I come to Thomas, knock on the door. Is Thomas here? Well, I have a search warrant. Ask to see it. He's supposed to get a copy of it. Well, I'm gonna search for, I'm gonna look. So am I gonna look, okay. Am I gonna look inside here for Thomas? No, right? I'm gonna look underneath the bed, I'm gonna look in the closet, I'm gonna look downstairs, I'm gonna look upstairs, I'm gonna look in the bedrooms, I'm gonna look wherever Thomas can go, the refrigerator, because we found people in refrigerators. I might look underneath the cabinet. You know, I'm gonna look underneath things where I can think a body can fit. Now, if it's a regular search warrant and I'm looking, say I know already Thomas is dirty, we got a search warrant, we come into the house, I'm looking for the drugs. I'm looking for the drugs, I already got a tip or whatever it is, here's a search warrant, I got it. So now I'm looking for drugs. That's when it gets a little trickier because now I can look everywhere. And then like you see on TV, some of those houses, they get torn up. Do you get compensated back for what we tear up? You can try. You can try, but you know, we're looking for guns, we're looking for drugs, whatever it is we're looking for that's on that warrant, but you can ask to see it. And if I come to the door and I'm dressed like this, I'm like I'm selling Avon or Jehovah's Witness. I don't know, you're gonna look like I'm not letting them in. So I'm supposed to have my badge. I'm supposed to have my badge out, my ID, so you can say, oh well, no, that is the police. What they want with me? Open the door. If you're like afraid, you can peek the door, well, can you show me your ID? And I'm gonna show you my ID, but you have to let us in. You don't get to say, no, you ain't coming in. Because I'm coming in. I already told you, this judge already ordered it. He said it's good that I can come in. And then they have no-knock warrants. We don't get to do that. The feds usually do that. But I went on a no-knock warrant one time, and I was like, ooh, this is going to be good. You know, like you see on television. No, they knocked. I could not believe it. I was like, I'm going back to the car. You know, just messed up my whole day. They really knocked on the door. I said, wait a minute. He said, it was a no-knock warrant. You ever see on TV, they just ram the door. They announce themselves, police, come in, as they're ramming the door. They didn't do that. I was like, God, spoiled it for me. But so they have those warrants, but those usually come from federal agents or maybe some multi-dictional, jurisdictional warrants or the CIA or whoever else. Usually we don't have those usually in our, with locals, municipalities. You know, state probably has them, but we don't. But you need to know what kind of warrant that we have before we come into your house. Because I shouldn't be opening drawers looking for you. Come back. That's it. Yeah, we're not gonna like I said, if we don't have like one of those warrants we could just bust through the door. It's not that. Unless it's emergent. Like if I see you running the house and I think and you're gonna go get something or weapons, we can come right behind you. You know, but if you just don't answer the door, oh well, I'll be back tomorrow. You gotta leave someday or we'll do stakeout. Which is like ridiculous because you're sitting out there for hours like, come on. The same way you see you, we see you, you see us, so you're not coming out. Is that my phone? I guess so. Okay. I didn't know I had that ringtone. So we have police encounters. Certain rights kicking when you're under arrest. I want to make sure I'm in time. Good? Okay. So certain rights kicking when you're under arrest. Important to know that you're under arrest. The best way to find out if you're under arrest is when the police start questioning you is to what? Ask, am I under arrest? Am I under arrest? So say you are under arrest. What's your name?
Bridget.
Come on, Bridget. Bridget's under arrest. I saw Bridget with my own eyes beating up D. She was beating D. So I get to the scene, we pull up, because somebody called us, we get up, I see Bridget, boom, I'm locking Bridget up. So now I said, okay, Bridget, I said, you're under arrest for assault. So I put you in the car. Get in the car. What am I supposed to do? That sounds good, right, on TV? He had the right to remain silent. That just looks so cool. He had the right to an attorney. No, I don't have to do that. That's television. Television is made like for TV. It's for entertainment. Television tells lies to your vision. Don't believe everything that you see. I don't have to Mirandize her. It looks cool, though. Oh, you have the right to remain silent. Everything you say, kid, you know, as you're putting in your car. No. I'm going to tell you when I have to start questioning you. And then and there, I saw it with my own two eyes, so it's my, you're under arrest for assault. I observed it, and it is what it is. Putting you in the car, I type up the complaint, and you get talk, you know, whatever, go to jail. Now, same scenario, you're in there. Now, if I want to find out why you were beating her up, you can tell me, you can beat her back, well, she started it first, and blah, blah, blah. You can talk all you want. I'm not going to tell you to shut up. You keep talking because those are spontaneous utterances. They can be used against you. So anytime that you get arrested, my best suggestion to you is to keep your mouth shut. I already told you, you didn't have to incriminate yourself, right? I already told you, don't invoke your Fifth Amendment rights. So shut up. You don't have to say anything. I could ask you 100 questions and you could answer them and it's legal. You do have to remember that I don't have now if I'm interrogating you. Which means it's a separate situation. You've been already processed, now I'm putting you in the room and I wanna find out what happened. So I'm gonna begin interrogating you. That's when your rights kick in. And I will read them to you and you will sign off them that you understand the rights that I'm giving you and then you can begin telling me what happened. Okay? So it becomes a little tricky. Like I can ask, well, what happened? You start something like, oh well, she said, I just, you know. Don't say anything. I already told you, you have the right not to incriminate yourself. You should call a lawyer as soon as possible. I know you guys are all spoiled if you're 18 and older, because everybody's 18 and older, right? So you're all spoiled by your cell phone, so you don't know nobody's number. You better know someone's number. Because a lot of times what happens, everybody wants their phone. No, you're not getting your phone. That becomes property. I'm not giving you your phone to get a phone call, a phone number out of it. So you should know a number. And moms who can call an attorney for you. A lot of you don't have attorney on speed dial unless you just, you know, doing some crazy stuff. You know, but you need to know a number. You have the right to make one phone call. You need to use that. Make sure you ask. I need to make a phone call. Make sure you ask. I need to make a phone call. You should all have a number of a person you can rely on to get you an attorney. And remember, as I told you before, anything you say, it'll be used against you. So those spontaneous utterances that you're in the back of my car and you're steady talking about it, man, she started, and look, I'm using all of that you're saying against you. I'm going to use it. So just remember, be mindful. Be careful about answering questions when I am interrogating you now about a crime that was, yes, sir. No, we don't listen to your phone calls. We don't listen. You have a phone in your cell. Most likely they have them now where they're inside the cell, or we'll take you out the cell to use them. I know we have them inside the cell where you can actually make a phone call. We don't listen in on your phone calls. What we won't allow you to do is make a phone call to, like, say if it's domestic violence, we need to know who you're calling. We need to know who you're calling, because if it's a domestic violence account and we see that you're calling your spouse and you just beat her up, that's a problem. So we cut your phone off. A lot of times in domestic violence, we'll let you make that phone call right there to call someone else, to let them know, and then we don't allow you to make any other calls. We really try not to, because more than likely, they want to call their spouse. Come on, don't press charges against me. You know, but I don't need your spouse to press charges against you in domestic violence laws. Yeah, you can get, we try not to stick to that one, you know, unless we have, if we have to remove you from the cell, because all it is pushing buttons and turning your phone on in our cell block. It's just a matter of pushing buttons, turning your phone on. So a lot of guys, they have their phone on all day. You can make as many calls as you want, because they're all collect, they're not coming, we're not billing for them, they collect calls. So you can make, yeah, we'll allow you to make phone calls. Yeah, we'll do it. And if you could yell for us, well, I want to make a phone call, my phone's not on, but we make, who are you calling? Like, we have to log who you're calling, because we want to make sure you're not calling a victim. You're not calling, you know, someone that you either had a crime with or someone that you're in cahoots with. So we will ask you and record who you're calling. Yes. Well, put it this way, it works in your favor. Like, it works in your favor. There's nothing, I'm gonna tell you, if you're a suspect, or if we think that you're suspicious about something, and you don't have idea, you don't wanna produce it, I'm going to take you and figure out who you are. Because again, but just like on a regular, I can honestly tell you that there's nothing in New Jersey law that says you have to produce ID. But it would be to your best interest, because I can tell you, I haven't seen it work in anybody's interest yet to say, I don't have no ID, I don't know, who am I? I don't know who I am. Because we can bring you in. And even with the motor vehicle, I don't have a motor vehicle book with me today. I usually bring it, a summons book. If you look at the book, we give you a ticket in lieu of an arrest. Like, every time we pull you over and I want to give you a ticket, I can actually take you to the station and bring you in. But we give you that summons on the street instead of that. In lieu of an arrest, we give you the motor vehicle summons, because you're going to promise to come back to court and to take care of it. Some states, you get taken in. I know Virginia, they can. A lot of times in Virginia, they take you in. So that's something to think about. So tell your friend, you're 100% right on the books, on the law books. There's nothing that says it, but it would be in your best interest, because you can be live scanned. They can bring you in and live scan you, which means put your hand in the system, you know, your prints. Yeah, I mean, he'll learn. Ooh, he's speeding. And he only got one ticket. He must be a smooth talker. Oh, he works for the government? Oh, he's all right. We have professional courtesies. You know, so we do have professional courtesies. If, you know, if you work for a government worker, we try to give, you know, sometimes people abuse that, but it's not like they can't get a ticket, because they can get a ticket. We do have a professional courtesy, but we don't like to give other cops tickets and government workers. But if you, there's nothing that says we can't. Is it just in bad taste? Yeah, it can be. But if you're a real jerk off, we're going to give you a ticket. I just going to be honest with you. Your father don't get tickets? Good. He's a cop? Oh, he's an air. Yeah, that's right. We respect our military guys. We don't want to give our military guys tickets. No. Master Sergeant, too? Yeah. Listen, I'm not a hypocrite. I speed. I do. I haven't. I'm going to be honest with you. I've never, in all these years, I've never given one speeding ticket out. Never. I'm not a hypocrite. I swear, I will give you everything else. I'll pull you over, I'm gonna give you that seatbelt ticket. And you're like, I got my seatbelt on. I'm like, shut up. Like, do you want the speeding ticket or you want the seatbelt ticket? Like, you know, so, you have to turn the mic on. Look, I'm giving you the seatbelt ticket. Shut up about it, okay? Turn the mic back on. So, you're getting this ticket for while wearing your seatbelt. Thank you, officer. Yes. So tickets are not mandatory unless it was an accident. Tickets are discretional. They're at our discretion. That's why the nicer you are to the officer at the scene, yes, officer, yes, ma'am, yes, sir, you may not likely, more than likely not get a ticket. Not likely. I'm telling you, it just all depends. But if you're real respectful, I'm telling you, 9 times out of 10, you won't get that ticket. We don't have to give out tickets. There's no, we don't have quotas. Do they expect us to give tickets? Yes, because guess what? We work 12-hour days on the road. So those of you that drive, anybody drive here today? Okay, so those that drove here today, how much foolishness and mayhem did you see on the road? People not putting on this signal, right? People not stopping. People doing, so if you see it, I'm a trained professional. I've been doing this for all these years. What do you think I see when I'm in my car? Foolishness and mayhem. So that's why we're pulling over, and part of our job is to keep the people, you know, safe on the road. So yes, we have to. So if you work 12-hour days, you mean to tell me you didn't see nobody run a light? You work 12 hours, you didn't see nobody not to put this signal on, nobody make a legal U-turn. Yes, and this is why they expect you to do something, to pull people over, because that's part of our job. It's part of our job to do that. We're trained at that. So that's why we have to do that. Make sure you keep me in time, because I could be all over. So handling officer misconduct. This is what I tell you. If you tell your homies, if you go to the beauty parlor, you go to the barbershop, and you're talking about the cop that pulled you over, the cop that stopped you, you're telling the wrong people. Because they're going to be like, yeah, me too. Yeah, me too. Well, what are they going to, all you're doing is just gossiping. So you need to tell the right people. You need to file a report, file a complaint. Nobody wants to work with a rogue officer. I'm telling you now, we don't want to work with them. I used to have this guy work with, and now he's a lieutenant, and I'm like, how? How? He would go to a scene, and we're supposed to bring peace. He would cause so much chaos. I was like, this guy is a, I would make him go, get back in the car, I got this. Some people just like they rah-rah. No, stop. We're not supposed to do that. We're supposed to come here and bring peace, find out what's going on, make sure everything is calm. You can't come to a scene and cause more chaos. Anyway, and I don't want to work with people like that. Nobody wants to work with people like that.
Not many lieutenants at least slept in the office away from
you. Yes, okay. And I still be blasting him. He said, boy, I said, I don't care, because I don't care what bars you have. You're disrespectful to the public. So you're disrespectful to the public, you're disrespectful to me. What did you say? Did you give him permission?
Yes.
See, you can't, they can.
Because I was, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, okay, so you, you, you could say no. No, you could say
no.
Oh, what you gonna arrest me for? Like, okay, you get pulled over. See, and this is what, this is why we, I talk about policing differently. You get pulled over and you're gonna get officers, you know, they do have fishing details. They should be fishermen instead of police officers. That's what I say. So you took, you picked the wrong profession. So you're weaving in and out of traffic. So I may check you to see if you're intoxicated or to see if you're a diabetic or to see, you know, why you're weaving or just because you're a bad driver. You know, it could be those things. What am I looking for in your truck that's going to determine why you would, unless you got somebody in the car that's going to stop, you know. So I don't, right, so you just comply. Right, you just comply. You said, go ahead, because you had nothing to hide. And you said, go ahead, if you're going to make me happy, go in my trunk. You can comply. You don't, but there was no probable cause for them to go into your trunk. So you can technically say no. Let them get a search warrant. Now you're afraid, you're by yourself, it's late at night, two officers, you just said, you know what, that's when it comes in. What time is it? 11:45. What car is that? Number 216. And you write that down because you're gonna file a complaint now. I wanna know why these officers asked me to go into my trunk when all they said I was weaving in and out of traffic. You have to make, because guess what? The next person they're gonna go ask the same thing. Why are you asking, why are you fishing? If they're fishing, they're not fishermen. They're looking for something that's not there. And this is why you have, so comply, because I always say comply. I always say you have to just comply because you can complain later because there's no right, there was no probable cause for them to go into your trunk. Did they go inside your vehicle and open up the inside of your vehicle? They had more probable cause or whatever to do that than they had to go in the trunk. So that disturbs me. All your stuff was in there. Don't steal my stuff. I'd have got out the car too. Can I get out the car? Well, make sure you leave my Louis shoes in there. But yeah, no, there was no reason. So you, again, that was a moment at that point in time where you could have made an inquiry into why that was done. You can't leave stuff like that on the table because then they'll stop doing it after a while. It's like, hold on, what are you doing, bro? Why are you going in people's trunks? Like, what is your reason behind it? It will get addressed, trust me. We have internal affairs and they do address those things. Nobody likes to go to internal affairs. It's like the Hulk, boom, 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 you know? Well, you can ask, you can always ask, is there a reason why you want to go in my trunk? I'd be curious as to what the answer would be. And then, if it just sounds a little off to you, just say, you know what, if you feel uncomfortable in your surroundings or you were at a disadvantage, and I would just say, go ahead, I'm popping the trunk, go ahead. But it's no reason. Like, you have, so that's why, you know, again, we have a right to be protected. You're supposed to be protecting and serving us. So you have to, it's a thin line. You know, if they really had probable cause or reason, they would get a search warrant to go into Trump or they would, you know, do a lot of other things. But so ask, you have to ask, and then if you don't feel that your answer was correct, go to the next step. Go to the next step. You should know who the name of the officers are. If you see, they usually have a name badge. Try to remember them. Try to remember their face, the time it is, the car, where you are. Because I can look, all I gotta do is look it up in the CAD on our computers to see who pulled you over, what time, when, and where. See, but you need to know your information. Be accurate. Don't think you need to know. You don't have to have it notarized, but it's good to have it documented. All your facts. Make sure your facts are right, because this one little fact will throw everything off. You want to make sure all your facts are as correct as possible. Basic information, the name, the badge number, the vehicle number, the incident, what, when, and where it happened. Where were you? I was right in front of the bookstore of Stockton University. Boom, you know, what time? It was 12 o'clock. Have the information. Contact the agency where the officer is employed, because everybody has an Office of Professional Standards or our internal affairs. Everyone has it. So if you have to make that report. Don't just assume that, well, I'm just gonna leave it for the next person. We're all responsible for the next person. Citizen complaints, they're official when a written statement is made and submitted. You can have someone else call on your behalf if you feel uncomfortable. If you're a juvenile, you can walk into a station and file a complaint against an officer. We don't need mom and dad to be there. Yes. No, it just can't be open. Like, you go to the liquor store, you put it in the back of the car, it just can't be open. You're not supposed to have an open container. But if you did drink some wine and you're bringing it home because you got leftover, put it in the trunk. You know, I wouldn't have it in my seat. I'll put it in the back seat. Well, I'm driving in the front. You know, it's in a box, it's in a bag, it's wrapped up, you know. But you can, and it's so funny because as a juvenile, you can transport liquor. You can become a delivery driver for a liquor store, but you can't drink it, right? But you can deliver alcohol. You can work for a liquor store and deliver alcohol. But if you're under 21, and your passenger can't drink, just because your passenger, you're sitting there, you're driving, your passenger getting drunk, that don't work. Your passenger can't drink either. No open containers at all. None. Got it? And then you wait for a reasonable, yeah, everybody in the car can't be getting high and getting drunk and you're the driver. I'm the one, I'm the designated driver. No, you the fool because you're gonna get the ticket, okay? That's all that is, yeah. Empty containers? I don't know why, it depends. If they don't smell it on your breath, yeah, if they don't smell it on your breath, if they smell it on your breath, you got all the beer cans in the back because you're just driving your tears, you're throwing the cans and you're gonna get got, yeah. You know, so it's a DWI, which is a lot different because DWI is an arrest. It's not just Title 39. You can get arrested for that. So again, with filing complaints, you have to allow for time. You have to allow for the investigation to be done, to be conducted. So don't think it's going to get done within, you know, again, within these 30 days now. Remember, within the 30 days, this goes to the OAG, the Attorney General's office. Keep accurate accounts and follow up. You know, and if you still, you know, get an attorney, if you feel it isn't, you're not getting what you need, follow up. Don't just say, see, I feel like it was going to do nothing, just leave it. Again, if an incident of wrongdoing is not reported, then a conclusion can be drawn that nothing happened. It didn't happen. Trust me, they take these complaints and we also make new rules. You can be case law tomorrow. Tomorrow you could be in our New Jersey law books because of something that we did wrong. And now it has to be corrected. From now on, this is what you're gonna do. So it's always good to make sure that if you feel that you were done wrong or unjust, something was unjust, you should follow up. Future civil, you can sue, you know, anything. So make the complaint. So this is what I was talking about when we do for the young adults, when we talk about educate yourself about criminal laws because you want to avoid pitfalls that lead to punishment by the criminal justice system, to guarantee that your future stays on track, to educate your friends and family about the law. When driving, understand that driving is a privilege, not a right. That's why we can take your license. Because if it was a right, we wouldn't be able to take your license. Obey the rules of the road. Be aware that drinking and driving puts you and others in danger. Avoid driving aggressively. Follow the speed limit. I try. Assault and battery. Be careful about getting into fights. You could be charged with assault. A missed punch can be the crime of an assault. Crime and battery and assault is the same. Oh, I missed it. Conspiracy. Teamwork is usually a good thing, but when you use for illegal purposes, it's a crime of conspiracy. When you're in conspiracy, you can be charged with whatever crime somebody else in the group did. So you with your friends, they rob a bank, and you just happen to be at the house while they count the money. They can say, oh no, she was there. Bridget was there. She conspired. It is crazy. That's why I say, know who you're with. Know your friends. Murder. You can be charged with murder if you give somebody a beat down and you harm them and they die. They hit their head on the sidewalk. They hit their head on the curb. They die. That's murder. Now it's going to get downgraded. But who wants to be charged with that? Who wants to be charged with aggravated assault or what is it called again? Say it again. No, it's manslaughter. Manslaughter. You can be charged with manslaughter. That's what they downgraded to manslaughter. Yes. No, we don't have that in New Jersey. It's self-defense. But we don't want you. Look, nobody says you have to get your butt whipped, right? However, be prepared for the consequences that follow it. Just be prepared, because if that happens and they hit their head on the curb and they die, manslaughter. You didn't mean to do it, but it happened. Manslaughter. We talk about cyberbullying and cyber harassment. Well, of course, they're cracking down. New Jersey now has a 2C33 law which handles that. Cyber harassment, cyber crimes. We finally caught up. Talk about a little bit, this is what I was telling you guys about democracy and laws. How are lawmakers elected? Anybody into politics here? Anybody want to be a policy? Ooh, look out. So, citizens register to vote. You got to register to vote. Are you guys all registered to vote? Everybody? Yes. Even though people think, oh, my vote doesn't count. If you do it on a local level, you have power. Start there. Voters choose a candidate who represents their interests. Voters vote for their candidates. Elected candidates become lawmakers. National laws, state and national laws made. A lawmaker has an idea, a problem, or to solve a problem. The idea is written down as a proposed law, which is a bill. The bill is read, discussed, debated, and usually changed and then voted on in legislative committees. Let me hear my rapid delight. How are state and national laws made? Again, continue. If the bill ultimately makes it out of the committee in Congress, it is voted on by the legislature. The bill is presented to the executive leader, the governor, president to sign. The executive leader may do one of three things: sign the bill, veto the bill, or leave the bill alone, which after a certain amount of days, it makes the bill a law. How interesting is that? So again, just to wrap this all up, just be careful of your association, your interaction with your friends. Try not to draw negative attention to yourself. Think about the consequences of your actions. Care about the consequences of your actions. Be cautious, polite, and remember your rights when encountering the police. Thank you. And since you guys are on a college campus, the police officers here are sworn officers. So these rules and laws apply to them as well. If you're in an environment like this, this is your home. This is your home now. This is your community. This is a mini community. So when you have officers who, you know, it may be a little strange if they're saying, hey, how you doing? Don't be taken aback to say, oh, hey, it's good to know a cop. Everybody should have a cop as a friend, at least one. Come on, you gotta have one friend as a cop. You have to, I'm telling you. So especially in a community like this, somebody you can call on and depend on when something happened, you know you got the end. I'm gonna call my friend officer such and such. Look, that's, you need to be friendly. If you see, you know, again, Chief Parker's here, she's here, and she wanted to make sure that let you guys know that she cares and about her officers. And if she has it, it comes from the top down. So if she cares, it's gonna trickle down to the officers because they know that she's not the one to play with. And if I say it's gonna go like this, and this is how I want you to treat, you know, our students, that's what they have to do. Otherwise, they have to get another job. Got it?